you've now made a living, a career in LA in the business, in the film business, doing a lot of television, a lot of hour-long television in the last few years.
Well, yeah, I did several movies as well.
Yes.
I did several movies, and in last years I was doing mostly television.
Did you ever expect that would be your career path for you, or is that part of your...
Well, I never watched myself as making any kind of the career. It was just working.
Okay.
And I did the television from the beginning, back in Poland when I started. I did several television movies, and I did also something which was called in this time the theater of the television, which was mostly the adaptation, the TV adaptation of the classical plays. So I liked television from the beginning, and I liked also the concept of the TV series. And it was some interesting even in communist Poland. So but it wasn't for me something like new or exotic.
Right.
And in the beginning of 21st century, I started to watch more carefully American television and realized that more and more, actually by in 90s already, more and more it becomes more interesting than the American cinema. And especially when HBO came on the market, but even before HBO, it was some TV series I found, you know, in some way more alive, brave, interesting than the most of the movies. It was the first seasons of ER, for example. I found it quite revolutionary, not only in way of doing this on moving camera and so, but also in terms of the subject, that it speaks something about this American society. Which I don't see in the movies very much.
No, they stopped that.
Yes.
It became commercially inviable, apparently. They
became global in some way, you know?
Yeah.
So the purely American subject disappeared. And for example, when I did some episodes of The Wire, I watched, you know, first season, I came to the second season, and even third. And I watched first two seasons, and I was like blown away, you know? It was like reading great American novel. It was something which I haven't seen in the movies. I even thought, you know, it's such a rich material, let's cut it to the two long feature films.
Yeah.
But they said, why?
So is the trick of it for you to find television projects that carry enough weight to make it interesting, so you're not just kind of shooting?
Right. Yeah, it means I'm not interested in mediocre television, I'm interested in really good television. In great stories with the brave writers, with, you know, fantastic actors, and some kind of the stylistic freedom you don't have in the movies anymore. It means you can play with the style
and
much more.
And is the process of actually working on those shows, because the writers tend to be dominant on television more than directors.
They are.
Is that freeing for you, so that you can play a little more, or less of a burden, or what do you think?
Yeah, it is in some way some kind of the relief, you know, that I'm not carrying everything on my shoulders, and that it's quick. The episode is 1 month of work, you know, to making any kind of the movie, even small independent movies, at least 2 years and sometimes longer. So this quickness of the things, you know, it is it's energetic. It gives me some kind of the stamina. It's good. But of course, you know, for the directors, in some point it will be, I'm doing not too much of that. I'm doing like probably 1-2 episodes by year, not more. If it will be more, I think I will be frustrated. I think suddenly, you know, I see that my vision is not the most important. I have to serve somebody's vision all the time. Doing pilot, I did the pilot of Tremé, of the show in New Orleans. And then it was really cool. It was really cool. But after, you know, I did the pilot, I set certain standards. And after, not everybody, like, in my opinion, it's following my standards. They are doing different things, so that it can also be frustrated.
Yeah.
But it's different kind of the work. I think that the most satisfying is to develop own series and do it, you know, all the time. I did it in Poland, and we co-directed with my daughter, who is a director also, and my sister, who is also a film director. So we did 14 episodes of the original, developed by us and directed by us. TV
Fairly
series.
Recently, or.
It was like 4 years ago, 3.5 years ago. And it was important, like, piece on the Polish television. And actually we sold it to some cable here also. And, you know, it was great. It was hard work, but it was very, you know, very rewarding.
But wasn't the Decalogue originally made for television?
Decalogue have been made for television, yes. So have you seen, and it was like 20 years ago, even more. So you've seen in Poland, it was this tradition. with the public television, which was only public television at this mm-hmm. time. Now, unfortunately, the television in Poland is not so good. Mm. So it's why I'm doing mostly American one.
Yeah, there's a great documentary. It's not a great documentary, but it's a good documentary that has a great subject about the guy who created Everybody Loves Raymond mm-hmm. being asked to go over to Russia to convert the show for Russian television mm-hmm. and how completely confusing and disconnected it was for him, but apparently now a big hit in Russia.
You see?
The Nanny is the biggest hit.
The Nanny is in Poland also a big hit, yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, but Nanny is kind of, you know, fairy tales, universal.
It is not Tremé.
No, it's not like Tremé. It will be very difficult to convert to Tremé. It's why, you know, I like David Simons, especially in stories, because they are so deeply American, and I'm missing this. You know, I thought that the Americans lost their own culture in some way, you know, spreading into some kind of the global, you know, whatever.
Well, as it gets more, spend more money, they want to get more global.
Exactly, but, exactly. Yeah. Suddenly, from the moment that they started to realize that they make better income from the, you know, foreign box office than from the American domestic, they started to think about foreign more than about domestic.
So do you think about, when you go into a project like In Darkness, do you think about the outcome, financial outcome of these movies, or are you just trying to figure out how to get your art paid for and make your movie?
Within Darkness is something which I tried to make right in the first place, which is not easy, never, because, you know, making the journey to the sewers and making the journey to the Second World War and to the experience of the Holocaust, it's extremely painful. And if you want to be, and my aim was to be as real as possible on all levels. So it means that you have really, really, like, let everybody to be with you and go together on this journey, which is, like, not such a nice journey.
Mm-hmm. No.
So that is the first thing I'm thinking. And you know that we are not doing it for money, you know, because if I want to do something for money, it's another genres which are much more popular.
Right.
I'm doing it to tell some important story, and I try to do it in the way that it will be so powerful, so emotional, so honest, that I hope that the people will come with some help.
So are the people who fund a movie like this kind of there because they want to be part of that experience as opposed to the normal way they might fund movies?
It's, you know, it's European movie. It means it's some Canadian also, but the Canadian fund finally, Telefilm Canada, they step out because we didn't shoot the movie in English. We shot it in real languages of the story. So suddenly they said that they are not interested. But some money came from Canada. And from Germany, it came mostly from the, you know, different kind of the state funds or the funds, you know, connected to the particular city or something like that. That is how you finance European movies. Very few of them are financed by the real financiers, by banks or... or rich people, mostly is financed by some kind of the funds. And from Poland also, we have now pretty generous fund, you know, founding Polish National Cinema. And they are mostly small movies with relatively small budgets, but they are shot in freedom and with talent. So, you know, it's not such a bad situation.
No, it's great compared to here. In some ways, it's great because there really isn't funding here at all from the government or from...
And
those organizations.
Yeah, and it's very difficult to make really, you know, brave, courageous, independent movie in the States. That is the worst time I remember in my lifetime for this kind of the movies here. So in Europe, in some way, it's easier. But, you know, sometimes having it easy doesn't mean it helps you to do the good job. Sometimes you need the obstacles and to have the discipline. And I think that this combination of the American pressure of money, you know, and censorship, some kind of the financial censorship, and European, you know, kind of the desinvolture and the, you know, the freedom kind of the, you know, artist feeling, that this mix and combination is probably pretty good.
Yeah, well, it worked out here for sure.
Thank you.
So when did you first know about this story? Was it the book, or did you know about the story before the book even came out?
No, the book was written, the book which inspired the screenwriter was written in the 80s.
Ah.
And it was out of print when he started to look for that. The screenwriter is David Chamoun, and he's Canadian Jew. was reading in some newspaper the story, and he got like fascinated by that and started to look for the sources, and found this book and the documentary, which was made by British journalists in the 80s. It was documentary film for BBC as well, with the survivors. They've been still alive. So he bought the option to the book, and he took it as a main source of the, you know, story. And after he started to reunite different kind of the, you know, material and wrote the script, spec. No one paid him for that. And that was actually his first produced script. He was doing advertising before, but it became some kind of the obsession to him. So another obsession he had is that I will do the movie. He didn't know me, but he knew my films. And he knew the producers, Canadian producer I worked with before. So he sent it to me, and we met at the Toronto Film Festival, and I read it. I found it really interesting, but I told him, no, I did already the movies about it. I cannot go back to this. And also beyond, you want to make English-speaking film. I don't want to do another Holocaust English-speaking movie. I just don't think for me it's right.
More British accents.
So it took some years, you know, he came back and, you know, and convinced me finally, and then they agreed to my conditions. So we put this small money together with German guys who came on the board and Polish guys who've been supporting me, and we did it in very difficult conditions with a lot short time and a lot of pressure and talented crew and great actors. We did it.
Did you restructure the script at all? Was there a sense of...
We did it together. It means it was the process. We did together like two or three last versions of the script and trying different approach to some things. I found the script was good from the... I found it a bit too conventional. It means too well written in some way or too well constructed. So I wanted to open it up a bit. And but he was very, you know, very collaborative and very generous, and it was good collaboration.
So going back to this time period, was that easy? Was it different challenge? Did it feel different after these years?
It's, you know, it's more and more difficult in some way, you know, because I don't know. First, I'm older, and I'm less patient. I'm angry quickly, and don't have such a tolerance to the stupidity of the people and incompetence. So making any movie is more difficult for me today, or for the, at least for the people who are working with me. And also because in between Europa, which was 20 years ago, and now, it was many movies about the subject, and some of them required important movies like Schindler's List or The Pianist. And a lot have been not so important movies, but dealing with the subject and using this imaginary and showing this, you know, wires and skeletal bodies and all these things you connect to the image of the ghetto of concentration camp. And it is more and more difficult to make it fresh in the terms that to really move the audience, to really let people feel that it's real, that it, to have this experience, to have this real journey, you know. It's more difficult today. You have to be to work harder.
To work harder. So you, what do you do? Do you bury it in more emotionalism, or do you take away? I mean,
no, more truth. I think that the
it's
truth.
To dig deeper into the truth.
Right. Don't go to the stereotypes. You know, don't try to find the situations or images or human behavior which are deeper, which are, you know, which are maybe less graphic, less expressive in the, but like deeply touching, you know, the underconscious of us.
More universal?
More universal maybe also. I think that anything which is really truth, and if you try to communicate it in the, in really trying to, you know, understand the person who sits in front of you, it becomes universal. I don't think that something is automatically universal just because, you know, it's generic. I think that, you know, that first you have to be very specific, and after being honest in the specificity, to find the angle or to find the light to put on that it becomes universal. But I think it can be, any story can be universal, you know, Chinese, Japanese, Libanian, Iranian, Russian, even American.
Even American. It is kind of the eternal truth that it's all... You know, we want to put, everybody seems to want to put things in boxes and simplify. And it all seems to work out that the stuff that actually connects with people is the same. It doesn't matter what country, it doesn't matter what language, it doesn't matter, you know, it connects because it's human.
Right.
And it's bigger than all of us.
Yeah, but I think you have to have this attitude, you know, of the openness and expect the same kind of the, you know, it's like lasers, you know, it goes over air.
Yeah, sure. So, is casting the movie difficult, or were you familiar with all the actors who you wanted and?
I knew that I want the guy who plays Socha, who plays Polish sewer worker. I observed him, I watched him for a while, and he found that he's extremely interesting and very original, talented actor. And also the actress who plays his wife, I wanted to work with her for a long time. So those two I casted without making, you know, casting session. And other Polish actors I knew as well, but I had to do the casting to figure out who really is right for this or this part. And the German actors I knew from the movies, I met with them, but I didn't make the tests with them. So sometimes I like the situation when I can, even with the famous actor, to make the casting session, because sometimes you are surprised in the best and in the worst way. But sometimes it's impossible and sometimes it's not worth it. So it's I knew that only very devoted and very generous actors can go on this trip, because it also they needed to learn the languages they don't speak, like Yiddish or, you know, or Polish for Germans, or Bawak, which is a special slang of Polish Lwów, something like Cockney for Poles. So those actors had to do this exercise, this linguistic school, you know, in terms to go into the characters, which helped them actually. It was like, you know, method acting a bit. They had to learn a lot to become those people from, you know, 1943.
And the emotion that's involved with playing these characters and playing this story is, I guess, what you just expect actors to do. Less of a challenge, different kind of challenge.
When you are dealing with such a, you know, difficult reality, it certainly touches you deeply, you know. But of course, when you are working, you are not crying. I'm not crying when I'm working, you know. I'm very matter in fact, you know. I'm screaming eventually, but
So what's the set like? Was this set as hard to work in as it looks like from watching the movie, or was it more wide open than we would imagine?
well, some of that was on the stage, so, you know, so it was easier, of course, that it looks like. But it was not very nice stage, so. It was harsh. It was very, very, very cold winter, and very, you know, very German production in some way, with a lot of restrictions, and certainly not enough of money and time. So we had to put a lot of talent and energy and, you know, and perseverance to do it. It was struggle every day. For most of the crew, they said after, you know, it was the worst thing we ever did in terms of the working experience, but everybody at the same time was very proud that they did it. So I think it was like extreme sport.
So do you put the work on now like a glove? I mean, are you confident and comfortable that you're going to just get it? You know what you're doing and you're professional and you've been doing this so long that you got it? Or
You
is it
never
scary
know.
every time?
No, it's scary all the time, you know, till the moment when the first moment when you can see. If you are close to succeed, it's when you put, you know, the footage together, you have the first cut. And sometimes first cut is awful. Sometimes first cut is the worst. It's like, you know, somebody, one director, don't remember, who said that never your movie is as good as your footage and as bad as your first cut. But in the same time, you know, you can see if it's the grain of the real movie inside. And we've been watching it with my editor, and he was working by himself for a while, so he helped me, you know, not to have the shock. But it was like around 4 hours long, and we've been watching it, and I invited two or three friends just to have some fresh eye. And you know, after it finished, I felt that it works. It means I felt that we have the movie here, that we need now to, you know, to make it shorter and to make it stronger and to, you know, to imagine how, if we need any music or, you know, where we do and, you know, the things like that. But I felt that we have the movie. And after after first like test screenings we did, which been very emotional, I realized that we gave to the people some kind of the experience they didn't have before, and that they are responding.
Do you test in multiple countries, or do you just test?
We tested in Poland, in Germany, and actually I did also one or two screenings in LA.
Does it play differently?
You know, surprisingly, not so much. Not so much. It means even people, it's some differences, you know, and also some people who've been more like emotionally involved in the subject, they react probably more strongly. But for example, the people laughed in the same time, same moment, and they gasped in the same moment. It was like, it was same moment. So actually it was quite, as you say, universal. Mm.
So does a lot happen traditionally in your work in post, or are you, I mean, obviously you have to do the work of post, but does the movie change dramatically, or do you kind of know what you have once you go in there in the cutting room?
No, it didn't change dramatically. From the moment of the first cut, it changed like gradually.
Right.
It wasn't like huge jump.
And has that been the case with you most of your films, or?
No, sometimes it's different. Yeah. No, this one I think was pretty soon on the rails, and after it was just, you know, to push it in the right direction, not to derail it or something. It was interesting about the length that what we did, because I absolutely wanted to make it 2 hours, not longer. And any moment we started to cut down from 2 hours 20, it became longer in feeling, you know? It was like miraculous in some way. Because when we cut the scene in the sewer, when they are sitting and having some kind of life, which are not dramatic, if they don't last, if they don't take the time, they become the informations. And when it's information, you are bored, you know, after a while. So. Paradoxically, you know, when we tried to make it shorter, it felt longer. So we thought after many screenings that is probably like only possible length.
That's a natural length.
Yeah. But if not, and that took a long time, you know, because we really tried to, you know, to make it shorter. And also the technical post-production have been very long, very, very long, but it was because of money, I think, that, you know, producers ran out of money in some point and it was like waiting, so the movie was practically finished probably like 10 months after we finished cutting the picture, so it was long.
Yeah, there was a movie this last year that I saw an early cut of and it wasn't really working, and then they recut to, as you kind of say, make it all the action moments. You know, they took away all the lingering. The problem with the first version was that it was lingering so much that you were kind of like, nothing's happening. And after a while, you're seeing that nothing happening over and over again. Then they cut all of that stuff out, and now it's two, you know, beat, 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 story, 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 story. And you're kind of like, okay, somewhere in the middle is there cut. I don't know if they're going to have time to do it, but it's a fascinating thing.
Yeah, it's a fascinating process. It happened to me that I seen the first cut and it was really bad. It really didn't work at all. With two or three movies it happened, and then it's the moment of depression because you think I really screwed. And after actually you can work on that and find some shape of that which is right. And sometimes the length is very, you know, it's very subjective. And you can see it when you watch the movie which has 80 minutes and you have impression that it dragged forever, right?
Oh yeah.
And after you see something which has 2 hours, you don't feel it. So.
Yeah.
It is very subjective. But I remember really good movies which, you know, Kieślowski, my friend, Polish director, Krzysztof Kieślowski, he did the movie called Blind Chance, which was his Polish movie, I think very wonderful and very original. And he showed me shown me the first cut. And it was awful. It was really bad, you know. It was really, really bad, and he was desperate. And you know, after we've been discussing, and he was there, and he reshoot some things, and the masterpiece came out of that. So you know, you never have to lose the hope, but also you have to really work hard till the very end.
Yeah, and we were talking to animation directors the last couple of weeks, and it's been fascinating because they were live action directors who became animation directors. And this idea of the energy on a set that's you know, human, that you can't change. The actors bring something, you don't know what it's going to be, and you're kind of stuck with it once you have it, versus the control of animation and how trying to figure out the mixture is mm-hmm. enormously challenging for all those reasons, that you don't, kind of finding the right thing is more challenging than I think any, there's no recipe. Mm. It's kind of like I know it when I see it. It's the old Supreme Court porn thing, I guess, or obscenity.
I cannot imagine myself doing animation, you know.
Might be interesting.
Well, but you need to be really patient, you know.
Yes, that's true. I think well, you're just saying you're getting less patient, so.
Well, exactly.
So when you do a movie like this, obviously there is a huge group of people that see this as very personal and very much a cause, really, in some ways. Mm-hmm. Is that odd for you? Is that something you're even, that you try not to think about or consider? Because it becomes a flag bearer in some
you
ways.
You have to forget it at some point, you know. It means to have this kind of the feeling of the humility someplace mm-hmm. behind your head. But, you know, the director is a god. You have to believe that it's all is yours. Mm-hmm. That is, you know, the first thing you have to appropriate the work of everybody, you know, and to steal from the people the best thing they have and mm-hmm. use it. And if something don't like, throw away, you know. Mm-hmm. That is my job.
So does it make it easier or harder for you? I mean, let me ask you this. Do you have perspective? Do you look back at your work? Do you?
I do back, not too much, but I do, yeah. Sometimes I rewatched my movies if it's in the mm-hmm. in some way connected to something I'm doing now, or sometimes by chance I'm zapping on the television and it just is on air. So mm-hmm. mostly that is very magical moment because, you know, I have the DVDs of all my movies. I can put it any right. time in there to watch it, but I'm not doing that. Right. But when I'm zapping and this movie's on air and I feel that in this very moment, somebody else and some people, some hundreds or thousands of people, I don't know how many, mm-hmm. are watching this, I cannot like just cut it down. I just have to watch it till the end.
So do you feel more objective about it when you see it in that way? Does it feel?
Some movies are disappointment after time. Some are disappointments. And but most of them I'm watching with some kind of the satisfaction.
And is that usually, has that been the case right after you've made a movie, or are you just
no,
sick
well,
of it at
not,
the time?
You are not objective for a while, you know. You are too connected to that, and it's too vivid, and, you know, mm-hmm. all the circumstances. You can really, I think you can take the kind of the distance after 3, 4, 5 years, not before. Mm-hmm. And mostly after doing another movie, because mm-hmm. if it's the last one, you are still, like, connected to that.
So I guess like the next girlfriend or next husband
right.
or whatever.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, it is very emotional, you know. You can compare every film to your child.
So
you have the young one, so imagine that, you know, if you will have 10 more, you know, you will be less emotional about this one.
That's true. It's hard to imagine. Mm-hmm. So when you were a young child, when you were a teenager, was this life what you were anticipating or hoping for? Was this in your mind as your future?
I was 15 when I decided I want to be movie director, so it was pretty young.
So you're just 15, that's it, I'm going to be a movie director?
Mm-hmm.
And did you have reason to think you could be a movie director? Mm-hmm. Was it?
I thought that, you know, I wanted to be a painter before. Mm-hmm. And I was pretty skilled, you know, child painter. Mm-hmm. But in some point I decided, and I realized rather, that I'm not as talented as I would like to be. And mm-hmm. more important, that it's not for me the only way to express myself, or that I will never fully express myself through you know, the visual art, mm-hmm. through that. So I started to ask myself what else I need to express, and I found that I love telling the stories, that I need to tell the stories, mm-hmm. and also that I need to have the power, mm-hmm. that I need to tell people what they have to do. Mm-hmm. So it was the best combination. It was to be a film director, especially that it was, you know, middle 60s, and cinema was mm-hmm. very exciting in this time. It was like real art, very, you know, new.
And did you know what it was to really be a film director outside of action and cut and all of, you know, that it was a combination of arts?
I knew a bit, yeah. I read a lot about it. I watched mm-hmm. a lot of movies. My uncle had been documentary director, so, you know, it wasn't the same. Mm-hmm. And he mostly drank, but, you know, but yeah, I went to some sets, but in the first place I realized that is exactly this combination of the things which is made specially for myself. Mm-hmm. And I went to the film school to Prague, which was very difficult to be admitted, and but I was. Mm-hmm. So I was 17, I was pretentious, you know, I thought I'm good.
And have you just gotten better over the years as you've aged?
That I'm not sure. Certainly, I was intellectually brighter when I was young. I was reading incredible stuff. I was reading, you know, the philosophers. I was like really, really smart. And now I'm mostly watching, you know, American TV series. So it's certainly the decline.
So the nanny has destroyed you too.
Well, I'm not watching nanny.
Okay.
No.
We're watching.
I didn't went so, you know, low.
Put that down. The
but
tubes.
I did watch some sitcoms as well. So
we've destroyed you in this country.
Well, yeah, you know, the job destroyed me. You know, the director is the job for lazy people.
Really?
They say you every day. You know, it have be 6 o'clock. You know, it's your start. The car is 5:50. Mm-hmm. You know that you have. You are always pushed by the circumstances. It's very. Very small amount of space when you can really decide about yourself. So
And
you play that you have the power, but it's not true.
And has it been the life that you were hoping for when you were 15?
The
At
life
least in
is,
this regard, professionally?
The life, actually, I cannot complain because, you know, I was Polish, half Polish, half Jewish girl in communist, you know, in communist Poland with no connections, no money, nothing. And I'm speaking to you now in Hollywood, right? And I am like world-class director, so I cannot complain, really. But the cinema became less interesting than it was when I started doing it.
But you'll keep the fire burning.
I try.